Energy transfers. We have 375 grams of water in a calorimeter, and both are at a temperature of 23.0 degrees Celsius. A 124 gram piece of iron at 85.0 degrees Celsius is placed inside. The specific heat of water is 4.184 joules per gram degree Celsius, and that of iron is 0.444 joules per gram degree Celsius. The heat capacity of the calorimeter is 253 joules per degree Celsius. What is the final temperature of the water, iron, and the calorimeter? According to the first law of thermodynamics, the energy of the universe stays at a constant amount. We assume that the calorimeter is a perfectly isolated system, so no energy can enter or exit. The calorimeter is almost like its own universe. The amount of energy that is released by the hot metal will be equal to the amount of energy absorbed by the cold water and the calorimeter. Q depends on the amount of heat absorbed or released by different compounds in the system. Here, the hot compound, the metal, is put on the left side of the equation, and the two relatively cold compounds, the water and the calorimeter, are put on the right. It doesn't matter which side of the equation the negative sign is put on. It's there because energy transfers are inverses. The left side of the equation will lose exactly the same amount of heat that will be gained by the right side. Q is equal to the heat capacity multiplied by the temperature variation. It's also equal to the mass multiplied by the specific heat, and again by the temperature variation. In other words, the heat capacity of an object is its mass multiplied by its specific heat. The water and the calorimeter will heat up, while the metal will be cooled down. This exchange of energy will continue until the system reaches an equilibrium, so when the water, metal, and calorimeter are all at the same temperature. This final temperature is our unknown variable. The change in temperature, delta T, is equal to the final temperature minus the initial temperature. We insert the values for the initial temperature into our equation, and we leave the final temperature as a variable for which we will solve. All the equations in this course use temperature in kelvins rather than degrees Celsius. However, in this equation, it's only the change in temperature that gets multiplied. Since the variation in kelvins is the same as the variation in degrees Celsius, we can keep the temperature in degrees Celsius. The answer will be in degrees Celsius. However, if you want, you can always transform your values into kelvins and then turn your answer back into degrees Celsius at the end. We insert our values for mass, heat capacity, and our specific heats into the equation. Now our equation is ready to be solved. We multiply the mass by the specific heat. Then we distribute this factor into both the final and initial temperatures. We put all the terms with TF onto one side of the equation and leave the rest on the other side. Don't forget to take the negative sign into account. We add the terms, then divide both sides by 1877.056 to finish with a final temperature of 24.8 degrees Celsius. This is the final temperature of the calorimeter, the water, and the metal. This answer makes sense because it's fairly close to the initial temperature of the water. Water's specific heat is very big, so its temperature does not change very much, and instead, the metal is the one whose temperature changes a lot. Our answer has three significant digits because this is how many all the data in the question had.